Well, thank you, Tom, Denny, and Mike Datto for joining us today. Tom is the Chief Operating Officer of the Vaccine Institute, and Mike Datto is in charge of Director of the Clinical Labs for the Health System and Associate Vice President in the Health System. So today we really want to talk a little bit about testing, the kinds of tests, their efficacy, their turnaround time. So maybe we can start, Mike, can you tell us a little bit about, you know, we hear about deep nasal swabs, at-home nasal swabs, et cetera. Can you tell us a little bit about what you're actually using for tests in the clinic and what, if any, alternatives there are?
Sure, I'd be happy to. Thank you, Dr. Kornbluth, for the opportunity to meet and talk today. In our health system laboratories, we are doing predominantly what's being referred to as deep nasal swabs or nasopharyngeal swabs. They are one of, if not the most sensitive sampling methods to detect coronavirus. There are other sampling approaches, for example, sampling of the anterior nares or front of the nose. There are saliva tests that can be performed. For saliva and nasal testing, these can be either administered by a healthcare professional or self-collected. In terms of sensitivity for viral collection, like I said, nasopharyngeal is the highest sensitivity, followed by a provider-collected nasal swab, followed by self-collection of saliva or nasal swab. So in the health system where we're trying to get the highest probability of getting the detection of virus, we stick to what is arguably the least comfortable sampling approach, which is the nasopharyngeal swab.
So Tom, am I correct that you've done a little bit of calibration on the saliva testing and have concerns about that being a viable route forward at this moment?
Yeah, and thanks for having me here too, Dr. Kornbluth. We're hoping to develop an easy sample collection that would make this less intrusive for everyone. And we've been sampling saliva for a number of months now. The best that we're seeing is about an 80% to 83, 84% agreement with as the swab that Dr. Datto compared to the deep nasal swab. It seems that it's the most accurate, if you will, or concordance between the swab in early infection. So what you would call an acute infection, maybe the first 10 days or so. After 10 to maybe 15 days out, you start to see a wider spread of discordance between saliva and a nasopharyngeal swab in our experience. And I think I've talked to a few colleagues around the country in Seattle and Pittsburgh and others, and they're seeing pretty much the same rates as we are.
Mm-hmm. So when, Mike, when there's a positive test in the hospital, obviously you're dealing with possibly false positives, you get negatives, you may do get false negatives. Do you have to confirm tests over and over again or no?
No. So our false negative rate is quite low.
Mm-hmm.
Our providers tend to be very cautious and on occasion disbelieve negative results. So we have a lot of data on repeat testing of people where the clinical suspicion is a bit higher, mm-hmm. And they do a second test. It's a very small percentage of times, maybe 2 to 3% of the times where we get a discordant from a negative to a positive test.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that isn't to say that the sensitivity of our testing is 97% to 98% of 98%. Some patients, for whatever reason, don't shed a lot of virus in their upper respiratory tract and can be infected, but have negative results by our testing. Mm-hmm. So false negatives do occur. All of the lab-based platforms that we use have a sensitivity above 90%. The ones that we use at highest capacity, the Abbott M2000 and the Abbott Alenity, have a sensitivity probably around 97%.
Mm-hmm.
And the point of care testing that we use has the lowest sensitivity between 85 and 90%.
Got it.
But that has the benefit of having immediate results.
Right. So are we doing any antibody testing at all? I know, are we doing any in the clinic from Mike? And then Tom, I know that you've done a little bit of also experimental work with antibody testing. So are we using it in any way at all at this point?
A great question. Our laboratories have done a full validation of an antibody test, which involved testing several hundred clinical specimens. The performance of the assay is actually pretty good in terms of sensitivity and specificity. It's not as good as our RNA-based testing for detection of virus. But we have not activated that test because clinical demand to this point has been pretty low. It's not a good, the test itself can't be used as an indicator for resistance to reinfection because of the false positive rate. And the test is negative early in infection. So it can't really be used as a diagnostic tool either. But Dr. Denny's also done a lot of work on this and probably has some other thoughts as well.
Tom. Yeah, Tom?
Yeah, so we're doing a lot of clinical research studies with the antibody assays that we have. And I'll talk about the one of the most exciting ones, I think, for me recently that we've done in collaboration with Mike in the clinical lab. So in April, we were able to do a rapid seroprevalence study of everybody that showed up at the ER, that there was a sample of blood drawn and it went to Mike's shop. A couple days after that, you're able to use that as a residual sample. So we looked to see what percent of that cohort had antibody, and it was about 3.5%. We just recently repeated that study. And literally within the last couple weeks, and the data is just coming out the last couple days, and we're at about 10.2%.
Wow.
For those. Now, this time through, we did it a bit differently. We did this as an honest broker approach so that we can go back and not us, but someone else that will go back and look into the medical records and try to understand if these were individuals that were acute infection or if there's no evidence of acute infection. And perhaps that represents, you know, an older infection or maybe even an asymptomatic individual that converted. The other exciting part of it is we looked at everyone that made IgG antibody in this cohort of and looked to see if they were in agreement with a signal of an assay that was developed in the Singapore campus that correlates with neutralization. And what we found was a very small number of the overall group expressed that neutralizing antibody signal. So we're taking it a step further. David Montefiore, who's really one of the experts in the world at doing neutralization assays, is looking at all those IgG positive antibody cases and looking to see if there is a functional neutralization antibody. And we hope to know that in another few days. So we're trying to map out just when does an antibody response come up, an infection, and then when do you start to see neutralization? And then the long-term part of some of our work is how long-lasting is that? In other words, if you start to look at people 3 months out, 6 months out, you know, year out, will they have neutralization? And that's very relevant for developing vaccines and whether or not people are protected for another round of infection.
Right, right. Very interesting. So going back to the current clinical testing, Mike, what can people expect if they do have a test? What's your sort of turnaround time looking like? What's your capacity looking like, et cetera?
Sure. So currently we can perform about 1,400 to 1,500 tests a day in our clinical laboratories. Just for perspective, that's a very large volume. Our total volume of testing in health system laboratories is about 30,000 samples a day. So when we're talking 1,500, that's a big change from a couple months ago. If you are a hospital patient, meaning admitted in the hospital, the turnaround time is 1 to 2 hours. If you are being seen as an outpatient, our median turnaround time is about 12 hours. Of course, sometimes it's a little bit longer depending on the number of samples we get. We are fortunate to have that turnaround time for our Duke patients. As many of the people listening probably know, there are supply shortages for testing, and many of the commercial laboratories have turnaround times as high as 7 days right now.
Right.
So we maintain the ability to do very rapid testing through our Duke laboratories.
No, that's obviously important. So this is a little maybe speculative, far afield, but from, you know, you, I'm sure you're following sort of the vaccination literature. What are you all thinking? When might people start to see a vaccine? You know,
Tom, what do you think?
The video, but I'm just curious.
This is about 10 times a day, this question.
Yeah.
So I'm the cautious optimist, I guess. I think first quarter, I don't see how we get to having something that we feel we're ready to move forward with before first quarter of 21. And the reason I say that is we're starting, Chip Walter of the Institute is starting trials very soon. We're going to enroll 1,000 people here at Duke. They have to get a prime and a boost. So if they get enrolled in August, a month later, they'll get a booster vaccination. And then you have to follow them minimum of 6 months from that point to see if they have antibody responses and how strong the antibody responses are before you can even think about going to an EUA authorization of some sort. So I don't see this until early, sometime in first quarter. And then the real challenge is, although if it's some of the big players right now that are going ahead and manufacturing vaccine at risk, so they're making doses, you still have a supply chain issue of vialing those vaccines, getting them out around the world, around the country, and getting them administered. So I'm cautious, and I say, you know, but with some optimism, I think next spring and summer, we're looking at dosing people and administering them if we get an EUA approval on something. Mm-hmm. I hope it's sooner, but I will be very surprised if we can roll it out faster than that.
So for our listeners, can you define EUA approval?
Yeah, so EUA, so traditionally approvals take a very long process. When you're in a pandemic such as this, in the field for diagnostics or for vaccines or for drugs that are useful, you can apply to the FDA and it takes a sort of a different route and it's called emergency use authorization. And that then gives a licensure that that diagnostic or that vaccine or that medication can be used. Eventually, when the emergency is over, you have to go back and seek a permanent authorization or approval process. But these are fast track ways to get things out to help when you're in an emergency situation.
So finally, I just want to say, you know, we've heard a lot of concerns about undergraduates coming in. Well, we have a lot of graduate and professional students. And, you know, we had originally settled on a plan, where we would test all the undergraduates coming in. And I know we're starting to work on a larger sort of surveillance screening that Tom, you're playing a role in, and then Mike, we would confirm anything in the clinic for, you know, delivery of results, et cetera. I'm just wondering if you could each just comment on that briefly. No promises yet, but I know this is where we're working towards.
Well, from our standpoint, we're working very hard to bring this online in early August, and we're doing a lot of different things. So we've started securing supply chain of reagents that we wanted a 90-day supply in-house to support some of the assays that we're going to use for this. We're also going down the strategy of so-called pooling of samples, and that's where you take, in our example, we're going to take 5 samples, pool together, run that. And then if you get a positive within that pool, you do a process of deconvoluting the pool or splitting it and running those individuals to confirm who's positive. That's really the only way that we can get through large numbers in short periods of time. And to, in my view, to make a surveillance system work, you have to be able to turn around results quickly. So we're employing the use of some robotic devices to make those pools and to be able to hopefully get a very rapid turnaround time of the result. The other key part of this is, you know, the team that's looking at modeling and just who are you going to sample on campus. That's different than the testing part. We're trying to ramp up the testing capabilities and capacity, and then we'll have to work with the modelers to see which subsets or which groups of students get tested and how frequently.
So then, let's say you start finding positives, then Mike, they're going to come over to you. They're going to get a confirmatory test.
Yeah, I think to Tom's point, one of the most critical things is who do you test and how frequently? And the devil's sort of in the details of that with what do you do with the results? And I think the university has done a fantastic job actually over the past couple of weeks trying to sort through these very complex questions, because there is no answer that anyone can point to and say, that's the right answer. It's the best you can do is that's the best guess. But I think we're gonna make some really good guesses on what a good surveillance program looks like. Our clinical laboratories will continue to build out capacity. By mid-fall, I would expect our capacity to be up around 3,000 tests a day. With that capacity, we could easily help support the Vaccine Institute with screening programs. I know Tom is anxious to get back to his exciting research, and we can help shoulder back some of the screening capacity. In the short term, the Vaccine Institute is doing a great service to the university by providing some of the throughput through Tom's CLIA accredited laboratory to pick up the screening. So, but yes, when we find positives, they'll come over, go through one of our drive-through tents, roll down the window, get a swab. That's a bit of an exaggeration, but it's a good process, and get confirmed.
Okay, well, you know, I want to thank you both, not only for this conversation, but for everything you're doing. I know it's been kind of round the clock. I mean, you know, I see emails from people at all hours, and I hear about, Tom was talking about machines that got set up at 3 a.m., and I know the clinical volume is just, you know, unfortunately kept going up, but I think that the testing piece is incredibly important for both the Duke community and the larger community. So I want to thank you both very much. And thanks for this interview.
Thank you.